So I kind of like what they did here. I feel like they countered the draft pretty nicely.
10 seconds.
Splinter Blast is incredibly good at dealing with pushes as well. So
5 seconds remaining.
I like Danish's Bears draft, but it's always dangerous to go up against a push lineup. Even if you do draft well against it, you drop a little bit of the early game and they just start snowballing too heavily against you.
Okay, I'm gonna just, I guess my main, oh, Dota.
Oh, is it crashing for you?
Yeah.
I survived for now.
I think this entire computer just actually crashed. Okay, never mind, it's just Dota. This is like the 8th time it's happened to me. It's hard to develop a rhythm.
Yeah. I'm just trying to think of... I like the change-up that they did in running a better teamfight hero in Phoenix than the Earthshaker, because these pushes are going to come so early that the Earthshaker's not going to have his blink dagger yet, and as an offlaner and teamfighter, he's not very valuable at that point, unless you get rather lucky. But the Phoenix, all he needs is levels, and that'll certainly be attainable, especially if new teams start grouping up. Like, no matter how early you push, you have to group up, and that means the Phoenix is left, you know, some sort of opening to be able to get experience.
I think Phoenix, though, is kind of bad against Pugna, or it's rough at least. Oh, as soon as I get back to the game.
Yep.
It's frustrating.
It is. Imagine doing the MLG finals where all three of us are crashing constantly. That was rough. Fortunately, Zai and Eternal Envy have enough interesting things to say. Alright, so an early ward from the Ogre Magi, he TP'd out, and with his boots was, Anyway, the early TP out, they were able to get, a ward down, blocking out the camp. This Furion's gonna be looking to be rather obnoxious with his trance as well. Oh, Chocolate's going for it, by the way. This is the play every single time on Radiant's side. If you, if the supports don't come and contest you, go for that bounty run. Try and snatch it. It's so big. If you can snatch it as a Phoenix, because then you only need like 3 creeps to die in order to get.
Is it hard though?
It's really not that hard. You get the timing. You you stand right here. You stand right here. And at the right as the clock hits 0, you dive, and you just spam click. And then it's just like a 1v1. The only time you can't do that is if there's instant disablers. Okay. So if you're like versus a Rubik and Rubik's standing on the rune, don't risk it, because he'll just pick you up halfway through the flight.
You just die.
And then you die and lose. And you don't get the bounty rune, and you give away first blood. And then your team hates you. Oh, Noya got super unlucky. He missed out on, he was still uphill, so Arctic Burn actually missed, so FN will keep all his regen intact for the time being. It's interesting, though, that they have a switch up. It seems like the FN feels a lot more comfortable on the Windranger, mid against Hesta Joe, and then they're going to have Helen Alive playing the safe lane Pugna.
Alright, here we go.
Smoke gank in from Go Black. Hesta Joe, FN's really been plinking away at him with these small bits of harassment because he needs to bring him low enough for the kill range. Shackle Shot does land, and Hesta Joe has to book it hard right now away from that centaur. Go Black just gets in one right click, but will be failing that smoke gank. So nice response from Hesta Joe, and of course, Ryze as the Earthshaker being in a good spot to counter that gank.
Hey, did you take plinking from me?
No.
You sure?
Yeah, I'm definitely sure. Plinking is just a noise.
Yeah, but...
Plink, plink, plink.
I don't know, man. I feel like you took that from me.
Wow.
Or you got it from me.
Are you serious
right
now?
Yeah, I am.
I definitely used that word way before I met you.
Calling you up.
All right.
It's such a specific word that I say that nobody else says. Either we're meant for each other, Cap, or you took it from me.
Either I screwed you or you want to screw me. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
All right.
It's such a specific word.
You really can't get over it, can you?
I've been thinking about it for a while. All right, Hesterjo's getting a regen too. Like, what could have been a really, really good lane for new team off the bat just kind of goes the SF's way. Like, even if the Windranger is winning 10 CS to 7, whenever I talk about, like, winning a lane or something like that, I mean relative to both the time and the matchup. Like, a Windranger could be doing better than this against a Shadow Fiend is what I actually mean.
Yeah, because you know the SF is going to take over the lane quite severely, especially at level 5, and then he's Radiant Sight, so he has stacks to go through.
Yeah.
Like, you have to be really far ahead to stay ahead of an SF.
Exactly. I want to make that clear because I think people in the past said that I didn't. Whenever I say something like, if a Tidehunter, for example, like when S4 did it against Envy, is somewhat even in the matchup, then I consider that a win.
Oh, yeah.
For the Tide. Just because the nature of the matchup is meant to be advantage one way or another. But, I mean, FN's doing still just perfectly fine. Like, no issues so far. 15 CS at 3 minutes isn't too bad. But it's more just you would have liked to see that gank from Goblack succeed. Because he devoted not getting boots, obviously. He had to use a smoke for that as well, which, you know, further cripples him, and even more than that, the amount of time that he had to waste, that hurts him a lot more than it hurts FN, for example, who's playing mid now.
Yeah, it wasn't just one of those drive-back ganks. He fully committed all the way behind the tier 1 tower and even sat there for a little bit waiting out the opportunity. So that was like a solid minute and a half worth of commitment.
Yeah, they actually swapped roles around.
Yeah, I was mentioning that earlier. Hesterjo probably just feels more comfortable on the Windranger.
Wait, what?
Yes.
Sorry, FN.
Yeah. FN's a pretty beast mid laner, too. I know that from experience. He's really, really strong in that lane. He kind of understands, like, the min-max aspect of it. And
yeah.
There's not a whole lot of stacks in this jungle camp, if at all, actually, so far for this Shadow Fiend.
Not like, while I'm around.
He actually has none, if I'm seeing this correctly, which, as an observer, I have map hacks, so I do. And that's kind of negates the advantage that he could kind of go back to now. Like, I'm pretty surprised that they've got heroes to do it, too. Like, you've got an Earthshaker who has essentially kind of, like, camped around. I think he'd be making better use of his time just instead of saving, like, the Phoenix, for example, who's already crippled, helping out the Shadow Fiend a little bit more.
Radiant's top tower. Well, he manages to spoil two different of the Go Black ganks.
Oh, mid.
At the very least. And middle lane. Oh, he managed to pick up the first blood just in time against Seedoy, but FN does get the turnaround kill and will be able to have his level 7 now. One whole level above the SF. Chocolate's still trying to make this work. He's going to dive away just in time. And this looks to be a very early tier 1 tower. Dropping, and this is the power of a safe lane Pugna.
Yeah, I think Alliance actually experimented with this a few times. You just essentially run at the enemy team, and they're trying to make a move on Ryze, but this is a little bit too aggressive. And there's going to be a TP from the Shadow Fiend. I actually think if he TPs to the tier 1, maybe they have an opportunity to go for gank. I guess Ryze is out of mana, so it was kind of low percentage, but. Oh, that's a surprise.
Looks like Windranger dropped pretty low and Winter Wyvern thought he was going to be able to get aggressive on it, but doesn't work out. And FN, he's got to be careful here. He's going to run into
Ryze. Fissure blocked out.
Yeah, they'll Fissure block him out, but still, I don't think they would have been able to get that kill. In fact, I could guarantee it. There's no way they get that kill.
It's only level 1 Fire Spirits.
Yeah, Fire Spirits level 1 does so little damage. Okay. 10 damage a second.
I thought he was 2.
No.
It triples at that point.
Yeah. 200% increase in damage, you'd say. It's like Phoenix and Clockwork are the two heroes that their killing capability like doubles or triples at level 3. If you build it the killing way. Yeah.
This game, the opposite side has just happened though. Like the Winter Wyvern obviously dies, FN gets a kill also on the Shadow Fiend, and he got solo experience for that too, if you remember, because the Nature's Prophet died. And so everything is kind of going his way this time around, and it's kind of up to him now to go pretty insane.
Yeah.
Nuh-uh. You gotta have the same performance now on the flip side.
So ring complete for the Earthshaker. Oh, they're gonna go for the quick kill on FN. One raise, two raise, long range? No! Hestujo needed that long range one, but he did not expect it was needed, I think. And misses out on the quick kill on FN. That would have been a big turnaround. Especially with the way you were talking about how FN does need to really stay ahead at this point. Fisher missing out once again. And Hestujo kind of trapped.
Alright, so how's the
top lane? Looks like Hell in a Line's gonna go down. The early rotation out from the Clinks. They gotta be careful with Shocklit, but. A blast?
Oh,
a blast?
Get one
a
more?
Blast? He's dead. Oh, the Furion ult actually came in time. So he was dead either way.
He gets XP though.
Yeah.
And more importantly, Phoenix doesn't get XP.
Oh, yeah, that's actually so necessary. He is level 4, so it's not. Too bad at 8 minutes in, like, obviously that's bad for any offlaner, but Phoenix, I think it's acceptable, just because it's so easy to shut him out at level 1.
Yeah. I would actually kind of like to see Ace go for the Solar Crest build this game, rather than the pure Deso.
Just for the early damage?
Yeah, it works well against the Windranger too, and,
But wouldn't the Desolator offer you more split pushing power, though?
I'm trying to think right now.
Comes? Okay. I'll give you some time.
I think as a team fight item, it's going to be better for you, but I think the Deso will be better for pickoffs.
Yeah.
Just depends on the direction that you want to take this game. Maybe if you're playing against a Nature's Prophet, you go for the Deso, just so you can, like, four-shot him. That'd be pretty useful. Like, Klinks as a carry is kind of useful against the Chen, just because you can eat his creeps, right?
Yeah.
The Death Pack range is small, but it's still big enough. Nice, he is going to go for the Medallion. Go me.
Go you, dude.
Or maybe he's not. Maybe he's going for Orchid.
What?
I wouldn't like that, though.
Does Decrepify not work right away? Does it not stop projectiles already in the air?
It should. I thought it did.
I just watched Winter Wyvern kill the ward, even though it was Decrept.
Oh, maybe it doesn't then. Maybe it works like Windrun.
It's kind of weird. I really thought it worked under attack. The way you did.
Was he Arctic burned up?
One man smoke? No. Ace is going to be caught out here. Ogre Magi gets there. I love this combination, too. It's so dirty. The Furion and Windranger.
Oh, I love that.
The synergy there is so good. Held alive. Oh, God, he's just barely going to survive. And SF actually gets immediately nuked down by Goblack.
Yeah, this mid game has completely gone the other way from the last one. As new team is just kind of rolling, FN has just completely gone bonkers this game. Hestujo Rotten is playing a much, much more fragile hero this time around. I think the biggest thing is just that he didn't have stacks to go back on.
Yeah.
Like, he didn't stack for himself. The Earthshaker didn't stack for him. That's not an insignificant thing at all in this mid lane.
Yeah, because if they had the early mech at this point in time, he would be so much more durable.
They would gladly take fights. You'd have a mech SF and a dark pacted, or what is it, death pacted Klinks.
Yeah.
You can easily take fights. You've got a hero that your carry can have like up to 1100 HP and just raw damage. Your mid hero can have the same amount plus the mech. That's insane.
But that didn't happen, and new team are actually getting a significant advantage now over Danish Bears. And that's even before the Tower Start kicking in. They've only taken one of them. But they're about to take a second in the middle lane. Oh, careful, Hestujo. He'll commit to the ward. Free 60 gold. I really feel like Pugnar is going to be... I don't know. That life drain is just so insane now. 250, even before Aghanim's, 250 per second at level 16.
Oh, yeah.
Just as the utility that allows you to be able, like, it's so long range, but also feeding it to an allied hero.
It's the old Lina cast range, too. For her Ag's upgraded ulti, 900 range. Oh, yeah. And then at max level, 1200.
Whoa, this is a heavy commitment. Helena's going to be in some trouble to commit the Supernova here. I think they realized that they had to make some sort of like major, overly committed jump in order to kill the Pugna, because they got to start slowing down these pushes.
It's more that they just have to kind of open up the map for themselves. Like, you can't just play the split push game and not have any towers down to begin with.
Yeah.
Because then it just makes new team's decision really easy, but
turn around
gonna come
here.
In.
Noyo's going to be going down. The Shackle Shot was well placed. Yellow Warrior is going to be picked off, and Go Black almost dies to Ace, but still a support for a support plus the tier 1 tower going to Danish Bears. They'll be perfectly happy with that trade-off.
Yeah, FN's about to complete his Aghanim Scepter, which is a weird statement to say because he hasn't bought any part of it. I'd imagine that's what he's going for, and I think that's what he should go for too, especially with the type of lead that he's built up. This Klinks, though, is going to go for the Medallion build, which I like. I advocated it in the beginning. I think if you have a mech SF especially, you kind of have to go for it. Like, you want to be able to take teamfights early, and it does help a ton.
Yeah. SF, oh, they picked off Sidoy at the bottom lane. Him and Ace. So that'll now complete the mech, and he has another 1,000 gold behind it. Do you think at this point he completes the Solar Quest? I would still like to see the Desolator before the Solar Quest.
I don't know. I'm a big fan of the Solar Quest in general, but like I've kind of experimented both ways. You know, it's not Storm, haha, but I've played the hero like 4 or 5 times just to see what it's like. And yeah, the Solar Crest seems to help a ton, but FN, he's out of Windrun charge. He's
very dead.
That's huge. He was about to complete his, I think he was like 300 gold from it. And now he's like 800. And then on top of that, you gave it to the SF, who just gets a cool like 600 gold as a result.
Yeah, he was very far behind. Now he's top of the net worth board. I mean, you're very far behind for SFs, you know?
Yeah. SF has always meant to be quite far ahead.
Yeah.
Now he's like more than 1k ahead of him.
Yeah, this basically gone back to a good SF game. I kind of feel like you have to be like 1k gold ahead by like 15 minutes and like 2k. Go Black's gonna be bursted down here. Oh, the mech actually saves him. Supernova laid out. New team can't fight into that one. Or maybe they can. They're gonna go for the egg. And Noya had already thrown down the Winter's Curse, and Ryze, who'd already thrown out the Fissure. There was no disables to combo with that one. So fortunately it doesn't work out. Noya is still gonna be run down as well. Fissure doesn't come in time. 7-8.
I think that egg was like the most optimistic thing ever.
It
looks
cool.
Oh, yeah,
it really was.
But when two heroes are prepped up, you don't have Winter's Curse or Fissure available. That's the issue.
I think he assumed there was a Fissure ready to go or something.
Yeah, he should have seen it though. I think they casted it like 4 or 5 seconds before. What's the cooldown? 13 or 11? You should know.
13.
We can just check. I think it's 13 too.
I was about to say 11 doesn't sound right.
Yeah, 11 would sound broken.
Yeah. Especially since the Fissure lasts for 8 seconds.
Wait, does it?
Yeah.
That's so long.
You know how many First Bloods I get? Offlane Earthshaker?
Man.
I just block out a carry and I've got a creep wave that's on them. They're just like,
do you know how long the Tusk one lasts for? The Eye Shards?
It lasts like a similar amount of time. It lasts like 5 seconds or something.
Wow, that's absurd.
Yeah.
Learn something new every day.
Those blocks are so good. I'm having a lot of fun with Tusk later.
I mean,
I played a game with him. We were far enough ahead. This is how you know we were far ahead. I got the Aghanim's upgrade.
Wow. I know that Tusk is still a broken hero.
Yeah, no, he definitely
in pubs, one shots like anybody. You're like a core with 1300 health? No problem. I've got like a medallion and an urn. Is under attack. Peace.
Yep.
He just ice shards you once to soften you up and then you're dead.
FN takes a little bit of damage, Winter's Curse, and he will definitely die to all this.
I mean,
they're not afraid of using Winter's Curse for FN, and I don't blame them at all. If they keep down FN, I think the whole entire like new team strategy falls apart. Hestijo is going to be comboed down, though, at the top lane.
That was... The thing is, you can't go for a gank on one side and then show one of your core heroes on the other.
Yeah.
I remember it was that time, like, the Phantom Lancer, I was telling you about that. When the Phantom Lancer runs away top, because the rest of his team is going for an aggressive maneuver. It's like the rest of your team goes for an aggressive maneuver, you can't show yourself on the map, because essentially what ends up happening is there's a decent chance that the enemy team is just going to be on that side that you're on.
Yeah.
It's like a 50-50 toss-up at that point, and then you're just trading away core hero for core hero.
The only way it goes well is if it turns out that that gank that your team is going for is into a full team fight, and then you're just like, well, I guess I have to split push now, but...
Yeah.
Chen picked off Ace with the Desolators, just gonna rip through that Chen every single time. They're gonna get the jump onto FN here. The Fisher, are they gonna make the dive here? I doubt it. Not a good time for Chocolate. Oh, we actually get silenced up. Oh dear, he didn't expect that one. He immediately goes down. Cedoy with the Orchid is able to stop him. Noya TP's out just in time. No Fisher to stop him.
What a back and forth game.
And again, that was just simply overly aggressive. There was no way they were ever gonna kill that Windranger.
It's also just because Sadoi's Orchid was like super unexpected.
Yeah.
Like, they had no idea that it was going to happen. And the Aghanim's Windranger comes out, but this is like an okay timing, but remember how early he could have had it.
Yeah.
This could have been like a 13-minute item for him, and that could have just been completely game-breaking. As it sounds, the game is still pretty close, with Ace and the Shadow Queen still doing really well. This Windranger's keeping up, and you've got a lot of teamfight, but I think the burden obviously is on new team with their strategy.
I didn't think they were going to contest, but they do have a lot of AoE combinations. They get a really good Winter's Curse on top of the Supernova. Jump in, Echo Slam as well. Rise, he picked that one up. Chocolate again immediately multicast, but still gets off the Supernova. He's going to get right clicked down very quickly, though. That's only a level one. Still, though, the rest of the team is going to be able to combo up very nicely and take out the rest of new team. Buyback immediately. They can't afford to lose this Roshan, but Zeno is definitely dead. Helena comes in for the side. Big Blast actually hit on two. Ace committing for Roshan here, trying to get it. Oh, and he just barely sneaks that Aegis away and will be able to get out. He's going to be able to get away from all of this one. Our SF, he's going to be able to get out. Ryze also gets away. Danish Bears. I thought that fight was going to turn nasty at the cost of, oh, Ryze, okay, he's dead. But still, the two cores survived and they kept the Aegis intact.
Yeah, the two cores surviving and the fact that the Klinks now has 10k net worth at this phase is pretty huge. And you committed a lot to try to get back into that fight too. Like, your Nature's Prophet just pretty much blew away whatever lead that he had.
Yep. Pugna's almost a non-factor. Like, we're getting to the point where he's not farmed enough, and the enemy team is getting farmed enough that you really can't play Pugna at such a net worth disadvantage. Yeah. Unless you're a support Pugna or something.
No, I actually completely agree. I think this is part of the issue with these, like, gimmicky strats, is that at some point they run out of steam and then... you sort of get rolled, but I think this lineup still has like a decent expiration time, but because you have physical damage dealers in the Windranger and the Nature's Prophet, like you can always fall back to the split pushing game, and the Pugna is not completely useless.
Yeah,
you have your ward, which is always going to be a factor in fights pretty much, but you're fighting against a team that probably has better late game than you and probably has actually definitely has better team fight than you.
Oh yeah, they invested pretty heavily with the rotating the Earthshaker into the support role and picking up the Phoenix as an offlaner. I think just guarantees you have better late game.
Oh yeah, especially when the Earthshaker already has his core item.
Oh, that tower going down is so nice. Phoenix is actually going to be able to complete the Midas now, which he desperately needs that level 2 Supernova. Level 1 Supernova is just so bad.
He's getting like killed by the Nature's Prophet every single time by himself.
Yeah. Yeah, level 1 Supernova I think really needs to go up to 6.
Nah. That hero doesn't need a buff.
I mean, the fact that one hero can kill it alone is pretty absurd. Helena Alive's gonna be going down.
Alright, he just got like 4 shot. I think they might actually keep going. You've got a 10 second BKB.
I think so? They committed a lot though.
Yeah, but you've got a 10 second BKB and you still have the egg and Ace has an Aegis. Maybe you go for the tier.
Oh, nice deny on that fan.
6 deny. He's got a blink now, too.
I think it would be unnecessary, essentially.
Oh, yeah, for sure. The Aegis lasts for enough time that you can farm out, heal up, wait for a cooldown, and then go for it.
Yeah, they could probably go for tier 2 top lane right now if they wanted.
The Phoenix is, like, desperately trying to hit 11.
Yeah. Go black. Yeah, you're dead. Oh, the last shot. Oh, 45 HP. Barely lives. due to his ultimate. He's trying to go for the early Aghanim Scepter, but it's just not going to be early enough at this rate.
I don't even
that
know
is
what that
one nice thing. I guess Chen gets a significant buff against Klinks because the Aghanim Scepter changed. He can't kill your creeps anymore because they're ancients.
I don't know. I think it helps, but at the same time, it doesn't do as much.
Yeah, Chen is still bad versus Klinks, but
it's just because you get picked off so quickly.
Yeah.
Oh, this Klinks is terrible, terrible damage. And then on top of that, he's got 4,100 gold. I kind of want to see an MKB now, actually.
Yeah, just shut down the Windranger. I would be perfectly fine with that one.
Or BKB. Take one of those two options. Flip a coin. If you trust in your team being able to save you with like the mech and the cold embrace, then build the MKB. If not, then build the BKB. He made his choice too.
Yeah. He doesn't trust his team. According to Blitz Dota.
It's not even trusting your team. I just couldn't think of a better term, but that probably puts them in a bad light. It's more just like you really want to be able to secure the fight for yourself.
You're securing your advantage. MKB is riskier.
Yeah.
And you'd be very reliant on your allies at that point.
Yeah, that's what I meant by it.
So they continue the push now. It just popped up with the timer, didn't it?
Yeah, I think it's like a minute.
Okay. I was about to say I completely missed it. I wish there was a button you could make the timer pop back up. Make Roshan pop up. Or make the fight recap pop up.
Yeah.
Radiant structures are fortified.
It's on my Christmas list.
Well, what if... Just in case, like, you know, people are cheating. Maybe that's why. I don't know. Respawns in 5 minutes, though. So at the 31-minute mark? Wait, I'm doing the math wrong here. 29-minute mark?
Hester Joe's dead. Or maybe not. Pops the ultimate. Is that damage reduction going to be enough? They get a Winter's Curse. FN is just barely surviving. Nice cold embrace. And FN, he's just going to have to keep on running and wait for Hester Joe to come back out. But a Fissure Block is going to keep him away. And Glimmer Cape, and Hester Joe's out. Noya's probably going to die in return, but that's probably for the best at this point. He'll give up his life to the Windranger. Ace, got to be careful there. Uphill advantage going to Helen alive. He's kind of stuck at this point. The ultimate goes out, the supernova plus the Fissure, and the Phoenix Egg will go off, it looks like, as Helen alive can't stop that one in time. He's definitely dead, and Seedoy is probably going to go down as well. Yeah, right click down by Ace, and it's just a disaster for new team. We're going to lose their neutral creeps on top of all of that.
Yeah, and you lost your cores as well. The only people that survive are the ones that are kind of irrelevant.
Yeah, Ogreman Giant, the only one who survived.
Yeah, and Hester Joe's just, you know, he gets out. He's pretty massive now. This Klinks is pretty much untouchable at this phase of the game. Like, once they get the next Aegis on him, I don't really know how they're going to kill him, especially with the BKB. And now he's going to go for the MKB. I don't even mind if he goes for a Daedalus, because I think he would just, like, two-shot people on the enemy team.
Oh, yeah.
He might even just, like, run into Goblack here, eat his creep in front of him, which would be a baller-ass move. And then kill him. Look at this.
Nom 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 nom. Three shot.
Don't even pop your ult, dog.
It's not gonna save you.
You have been purged.
He one shots range creeps, two shots each weapon.
I mean, Ace's farm is just unbelievable at this phase of the game. You can't reasonably expect a support to be able to survive against like a 500 moo speed skeleton man who eats your creep in front of you and then converts it into damage. He eats it and then shits it into damage. Amazing.
Bottom lane, they're going to go for Hester Joe, but they don't realize that Earthshaker was sitting there waiting to go. So Hester Joe just pops BKB, lets loose the ultimate, and the Phoenix jumps forward for the kill onto the Ogre Machai. And Windranger, the only hope, is blinking out and TPing away.
Yeah, she's going to be just fine, but still, like, attempt after attempt like this, you're just losing heroes and heroes. We said it was only the supports that managed to get out, but then like 10 seconds later, they also die. So you can call that like a really delayed team wipe because five heroes technically went down. Look at Ace, three shots Sedoya in this mid lane. And I mean, the early laning phase went pretty rough, but Danish Bears just seem a lot more on point with their chemistry and the way they're moving around the map. And Ace has just been a beast.
Yeah, I'm loving Ace. Playing this, he used to play the offlane, and I'm Really like Ant's movement as a carry.
He's aggressive.
Yeah.
I think it's also just new team should have had that sentry available. Like, they should have a sentry in all the key walking areas.
Yeah.
At this phase.
I mean, there's no reason. You committed double wards here, and you don't have a sentry to go with it. That makes little sense to me.
Yeah.
Because against these invis heroes that move around the map so much, like Klinks does, you gotta get the pairings up. You gotta get a ward counter ward.
What's the move now, Sam?
Phoenix now has Yule Scepter.
Go him. Sam.
What?
Ah, it's just a song that I'm thinking of. Oh, the Radiant Courier, though. Go, Yusidoi. Delay this game wherever you can. You have to. He just has to, like, beef up his heroes however he can. Like, artificial gold gains like this.
Yeah. Problem is, he killed 1,000 gold, right? Delayed it for 3 minutes, but that was the Ring of Akilla. He didn't even want that item. Still good. Just had it on the courier.
I mean, gold's gold, Cap. Don't be negative.
They'll have it MKBs on Ace. And I am being positive. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just being positive for Danish Bears.
That's true.
The winning team right now.
Once Roshan respawns, I think this is time to go high ground at this point. You don't really have to wait for the next set of anything. If you're Danish Bears, like...
No, certainly not.
You can get pretty aggressive now at this point in the game.
FN building into a BKB. I guess he has to against... Like, the Phoenix, he's, like, the requirement to kill the Phoenix. Oh, they're too slow. Throw down the counter ward a bit too late, and Ace, who popped a smoke there.
This is so huge. Ace, I think, is just saving in case, but I don't even think it matters. They're going to spot the Roshan and probably give up that tier 2 atop. This is kind of dangerous, though, because...
Yeah, they could just keep pushing.
Yeah, if new team... are aware of what's going on, which they should be, but once they show Helen alive at bottom, this kind of ends.
Yeah.
That's kind of rough.
So we now have an Aegis for Hester Joe?
No, I think Ace takes it.
Oh, what did he drop?
He had a
Sol Ring.
Oh, this is Sol Ring.
There's no reason for Hester Joe to take it. Attack. He's really tanky, and he doesn't output nearly as much damage as Ace potentially could. And Ace is the one I think that is a little bit more vulnerable on top of that. Because he's going to be your frontliner to hit the tower.
Yeah, I could see that. Aghanim Scepter for Go Black, so let's see if this changes things. He's already found an ancient granite golem, so that's a start.
I mean, all of his creeps are going to be beefy. Be huge beefcakes.
They changed the test of faith, right? Or sorry, the holy persuasion.
Huh?
Yeah. So it gives 1,000 minimum HP, and then on top of that, the ancient granite golem. So does that mean you could take like a small purge creep and make it 1,250 HP?
I'm not sure how it works out.
Or sorry, how much the golem increase his aura? 15. So. 11, 15.
It helps a lot. You can get the... I think the Black Dragon one actually sucks, right? Is that what I heard?
I forgot about the neutrals change.
It gives you 2 armor. That's what it is. Like
I think the Thunderhide is good now.
Because of the attack speed?
Let's see. Attack speed bonus and attack damage increase. 15%.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
It's a level 9 Chen, though. Bonus 15% HP though is not insignificant.
Xenoid picks
what a guy. That adds up, man. That's 2 towers worth of gold right there. Go you.
2 towers? Is that right? Yeah. Are you sure?
He got another one. That's the second one.
Yeah, but courier isn't worth a tier 1 tower, is it?
It's kind of close-ish in a roundabout way.
Okay.
In what way is it not, Cap?
I don't know, just simple gold metrics.
Hesta Joe. Oh, he gets spotted out. The ward counter ward combination here. They're trying to go for a very awkward gank.
Because they know that Ace isn't there. They kind of have to do this, actually. They know Ace isn't there. Ace is, like, desperately trying to run to his team. Because I think he senses that something's up.
Yeah. They're going to have the initiation here on Helen Alive with the Winter's Curse onto FN. And they're trying to pop Helen Alive. They pop the ultimate now on the SF, and that's almost enough. Helen Alive is somehow still alive, but finally he does go down. FN, in the meantime, trying to get away, is going to be spotted out by Noya here. And he will also fall. The Clink simply isn't needed.
No, that's kind of like the death knell for your team. When the Aegis Clinks with an MKB, Deso, BKB, Medallion isn't necessary, you're running into issues.
Yeah.
He's got 2.9k gold too. When he gets a crit, life's real rough.
Bloodlust, Ancient Granite Gold. Too bad it gets three shots still. He's desperately trying to keep it alive, but nope.
Okay, there goes that Axe advantage that we were talking about. Because the Clinks just destroys it with right clicks.
Like, I can't eat it, I'll just right click it. What I can't eat, I kill.
It's terrible for his insides. Imagine trying to chew up rocks.
Yeah, but he's a skeleton. What insides are there?
I don't know. You still got taste buds, dog. It's the last thing to go.
What? That's not true, is it? Is your tongue the last to come?
Dude, of course, you're insane. It's just a joke, Cap. Alright.
I mean, it was a really weird joke.
You know, it's like one of those like in NBA players. I watch sports a lot. It's like, you know, your jump is, or your shot is the last thing to go.
I actually don't know what that means.
It means, like, you know, when you shoot the ball, it's the last thing that fades away. It's like the first thing that goes is your speed when you get older.
Oh, yeah.
You just simply can't run as fast.
Talking about retiring and getting older. Okay. Yeah.
But
yeah, because that's just form, muscle memory.
Exactly. I mean, this game, though, I don't really know how to make this okay for new team. Because everybody's just under-leveled, under-farmed. Everybody from Danish Bears has the counter. I guess we can just talk about what Danish Bears did well overall this game. I think the map movement from your cores has been fantastic. Like, Ace has pretty much just been a monster this game. Ryze being able to get such a quick blink dagger really impacted fights early too. And
itemization.
Yeah, the itemization has been perfect from them too. Like, look at Ace just three shot that Clinks, or that Chen, sorry. And Hesta Joe Rotten now is caught up in farm too. Like, he's barely behind the Clinks. That's all we've been talking about, but this SF has like a full butterfly on top of all of his utility items now too. Like, this is not an underfarmed man whatsoever. And then on top of that, you've got the superior supports in the Winter Wyvern.
You're down.
That's got to be two towers now.
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, Sadoi's trying to do whatever he can to make this okay, but he's like desperately trying to get a hex. Just sell the Null Talisman, man. Is the Null Talisman worth more than a hex? No.
No.
That's what you have to debate. I hate doing this too because it means that you have an empty item slot. But at the same time,
you're about to lose a tier 3 tower.
Yeah, exactly.
No matter how big it is, thanks to Bloodlust, it's still going to die.
It's pretty engorged right now.
Yes. It's rather a red tower indeed.
Alright. They stole the Siege Creep, so there goes that push.
Alright. Siege Creep with Bloodlust.
Hell yeah.
Let's go.
That's an ancient creep now, as far as I'm concerned.
All right, go, Cardi.
What is he meant to do?
It's missing, so nothing so far.
He's attacking pretty fast, but...
It missed twice in a row.
Maybe if you just turn all your troops against it and wall your way into victory. Yeah, but I don't know if that's even enough at this point.
There it is. He did it. He did it, Blitz. Sidoi keeps his Null Talisman. All right, BKB for FN. This is essentially the last stand for new team.
Yeah, there's not much that you can do at this point. All right, it just gets eaten. FN spamming the D faces. But I think both teams are kind of aware what's going on, but you want to at least put out one more fight if you can help it. Ace has 5,800 gold.
Just bloodlusted the melee racks. All right, well, two already going to be down here. The supernova is not going to be addressed at all, so it'll explode in a big fire explosion. Stun up FN, whose BKB only gives him so much defense. And, oh, actually, not good. Oh, he does get out. Go black, not as lucky.
What does it matter, though, when your entire team just dies in, like, four hits, and Ace has a full crit on the way if he wants it. There's a fully completed MKB coming on the app. Like, this is, the amount of farm differential is just, like, absurd at this point.
Yeah, almost 30,000.
Yeah. I would have guessed maybe even more than that.
Yeah, you rarely see games go past 30,000 gold lead. If you've reached that point, it's either super, super late game, and if it's this early on in the game, it's just going to be super one-sided. So that brings our first series to a close. Congratulations, Danish Bears. They managed to take the series 2-0.